5 days after the first quake, Italian rescue workers struggled to douse a fire beneath a fallen office building downtown. Next door, Mexican volunteers pour through the rubble of the Regis Hotel. No one knows how many died here. They do know that only a handful escaped and that there are no more survivors. The dogs have been called off.
Today, two corpses died and they're dead. It's too late.
More than 50 people in the crowd on the curb had relatives staying at the hotel when the quake hit. They come close to see the latest corpse, but police urge them to go back. There is no way of telling who it was. Antonio Mejia Garcia was probably killed when the Regis collapsed. His parents want to know for sure, but they may never know. Throughout the night, workers scraped the ruins of a 12-story government housing complex. Hundreds of relatives and friends of those killed here look on. We want to do something, one man said, but we feel very helpless. I don't know what to feel, another said. I can't make sense of this. The corpse was one of more than two dozen uncovered this day. Fernando Juarez would collapse in tears minutes later. I could work for the rest of the night, he said, as long as I don't have to pull out more bodies. But many more would be uncovered soon, and many others would feel what Juarez felt, that this was a very senseless way to die. Matt Stevens, TV4 Eyewitness News, Mexico City. Three times a day, people within a 10-mile radius of El Centro go to the streets for water. They are told it will be a month before the pipes damaged in the quake can be repaired. But for many thousands, the pipes don't matter. Come and see where we lived, she says. See what happened to us. The tiny apartment buildings did not fall, but most are now unsafe, and the government has ordered them closed. So they live in the streets, thankful, they say, that the streets are still here and that the rainy season is over. 5 days after the quake, the Mexican government and the Red Cross send trucks carrying potable water to the neighborhoods. But the trucks never have enough for everyone, and those with empty buckets must find another location. Their faces show nothing out of the ordinary. These are the very poor of Mexico City. It only follows that the quake would steal much from them.
For the most part, the people consider themselves very lucky to be alive, and this just another inconvenience. Death to them is very difficult to understand. Hardship is not.
Tens of thousands of jobs are lost now, 50 here at a small clothing company. The building rattled so badly by the quake that it will have to be demolished. Owner Roberto Haddad will decide later if he can afford to stay in business. He has no insurance. For others, the trouble is much more urgent. At least 100 people complained to officials that nothing has been done to locate their relatives, all killed when this government office building collapsed. A clock nearby tells the story of kitchen workers and janitors buried in concrete. The important people had not yet arrived. The government says 30 people are known dead here, 12 others missing. But no mention is made of the daughter of Maria Sanchez Oscona. My Isabel, she says, worked here every day. The search for important documents and for the dead continues. Matt Stevens, TV4 Eyewitness News, Mexico City. Outside the government-owned General Hospital, doctors convince hundreds that the threat of disease is real. But the people are not waiting for shots. They're waiting for word of their relatives or friends. Are they alive? Are they dead? Are they missing? They stand at the gate waiting for a miracle, scanning the lists of names to see if there is still reason to wait. Lorenza Hernandez provides information on her daughter, whose baby girl was born here on September 18th. Both are missing.
Javier, ahí va el verde.
Two wings of the crowded hospital collapsed on September 19th. 200 people were buried, at least. Many of them were doctors, many were babies. Most would be taken out of the rubble, like this. We're not able to talk to them, he says, but we know of three people still alive in there. We can hear them. How long it would take to get to them, he couldn't say. The many rescue teams from other countries have their own methods. The French, very meticulous. The Americans, impatient, more concerned about time. Hours later, a 35-year-old man is taken out alive. The French are applauded for the rescue, but the other two people, both nurses, were found dead. A few miles away at the government-owned Juarez Hospital, a five-day-old baby is lowered from the pile of debris that was once the maternity wing, alive. Doctors call it a miracle. There would be nearly 60 more of these miracles in the next week, but time would eventually run out on anything good coming from something this bad. Matt Stevens, TV4 Eyewitness News, Mexico City. Sometimes disasters bring out the best in those who escape them. Thousands of volunteers from Mexico City and from around the world have done whatever they could to help here. Many will leave thinking only that it wasn't enough.
Is there any other extreme urgent traffic at this time?
Patrick McGrath, businessman and part-time ham radio operator, one of the few links between Mexico City and the rest of the world following the earthquake. Part-time has become full-time since September 19th for McGrath and for his wife.
I can't even tell you, we've got a stack of papers here about this thick, written on both sides that are full of requests.
I've had some sad stories of telling people that, you know, the father-in-law died or something of that sort. That's not fun at all. I don't think anybody has an idea what's going on here.
Really, you don't appreciate the things you have until suddenly you see those very things taken away from the people around you.
That's my dad.
John Rutherford's mother, Siva, and daughter, Jackie, knew that some Americans had been killed in the earthquake and that more were missing. After 4 days, they learned through a ham operator that John was alive and well.
I felt so glad when the ham operators called us. We celebrated. It was great.
Monica Pinal was taking a bath when the quake hit. She thought first of her children in Mexico City, and then of her children in Tucson.
Mi hija es muy nerviosa.
My daughter, Sylvia, is a very nervous person, she said. Sylvia and brother Rodolfo are students at the University of Arizona. As they watched their mother's taped interview, they recalled the panic they felt after learning of the earthquake.
I spent 5 days with the TV on and with the phone. I got a long cord, and I would take the phone everywhere, to the kitchen, to my bedroom, everywhere. I didn't know what to do.
You are scared, like, scared like crazy, but you never lose the hope that everything is fine, and this time, well, we're glad.
Whiskey 2 Bravo, okay. Foxtrot India, please be advised that Sandra Van has been contacted. Her mother is okay, and she requests the following. She is going.
Patrick McGrath was glad to have been of help to hundreds of people, and he will continue working full time until he's no longer needed. Matt Stevens, TV4 Eyewitness News, Mexico City.
Ay, dices, primero es parte, ok, espera.
Contrary to what a lot of people have assumed, this has not been a disaster which has produced large numbers of injured people.
Hola, buenos días, señor. ¿Cómo
sigue?
Volunteers at the ABC Hospital pay a visit to Alberto Jimenez Santo, one of the injured. He came to Mexico City for an operation on his one remaining leg. He lost that leg when the hotel where he stayed collapsed. There was hope before this that he would walk again with the help of an artificial device.
Okay.
Now he prays the infection won't kill him. The homeless outnumber by far the injured and the dead. The homeless poor live in the streets waiting for help from the government. In the days following the earthquake, more than 100 shipments of food, clothing, and medical supplies poured in from around the world. But officials here admit at least some of it is being stolen. The deliveries are constant and well supervised by the Mexican government and by the Red Cross. The storeroom is filled with boxes and bundles stamped with insignias. Stephen Friedman had heard enough rumors about government soldiers stealing supplies that he accompanied the shipment from American Express.
And we have turned the shipment over to the Red Cross here on the tarmac, and we have every confidence that it will get where it should go.
But many people, including Arnold Blaylock of Tucson, claim the Mexican Red Cross is also suspect.
Distribution is right.
Blaylock, a photographer, arrived in Mexico City the day after the earthquake of September 19th. He says most of his film was confiscated by Mexican soldiers, who also destroyed his camera. He was working for a private Mexican relief agency called CREA and said he was concerned about the supplies from foreign countries. So he followed one of the Red Cross trucks when it left the airport, followed it to a grocery store.
I would say it probably went on the shelves. It went in the back door. I didn't see him personally stamp the price on it and put it on the shelves, but it did go in the back door from the pickup truck. I can't say if that's happening with every one. This particular one, it did happen. The people are suffering bad in the streets, and they don't seem to be getting the help they should be getting.
It is testimony echoed by those who know best that help is, at best, too slow in coming. Matt Stevens, TV4 Eyewitness News, Mexico City. More than a million buildings in Mexico City did not fall, were not even damaged by the earthquake. About 350,000 people were affected in some way by the damage, but more than 16 million were not. Mexico City was hit very hard, but it was never devastated. What most people did before the earthquake, they did after it. A 1,200 square mile city slows down to take notice, but it doesn't stop. What did stop almost completely was tourism. This view of the famous pyramids at midday is rare, no people. If I sell, I make money, she says. If I don't sell, I don't make money. Pushing soft drinks on commission outside the Museum of Anthropology is a bad gamble 1 week after the earthquake. Finding a quiet place to siesta is much easier.
Somebody up there doesn't like me the last time.
U.S. Ambassador John Gavin shares the concern of thousands of Mexican business people and of the government. The cost of rebuilding will be high. The national debt is already impossible. And if the tourists continue to believe the worst, it won't matter that the head stayed on the Angel Monument this time around. No one but the natives will know it. Matt Stevens, TV4 Eyewitness News. Mexico City. Some of it would end today. Some of what they've been holding inside, the hundreds of people who knew that Vicky was never theirs to keep, but never thought they'd lose her so soon.
But should the angels call for her? Much sooner than we planned, we'll brave the bitter grief that comes and try to understand.
She led us on a campaign as no adult has ever led us.
She led us to a place where we began to realize that our children and our Lord Jesus Christ must be brought together, and that our children must be protected.
A child led them here, finally, and they were here for all children. A mother whose son died in much the same way. A father whose daughter lived apart from him, but never very far. Those who hope to find some sort of justice someday, and those who hope that justice will end another part of this. Fire officials doused the burning Cessna 150 by 8:30. There was nothing they could do to save the pilot and his passenger. A witness who lives in a trailer nearby heard the crash, ran to the scene, and said he saw one of the men trying to crawl out of the wreckage. The fire kept the witness at a distance. The crash site was small. The plane appeared to have hit nose first. No chance for an emergency landing. Sources speculated that there was too much fuel on board for a short flight. That, combined with the heat and the size of the two men, both over 6 feet two and 200 pounds, could have caused a problem.
Thank you, sir.
William Bavin, 66, the pilot, a former Royal Air Force flyer who was headed for Europe this Wednesday with his wife, Diane. He needed the flight time to keep his American pilot's license in good standing.
There's no speculation on what happened out here.
No, sir. We can't right now. The FAA will be here this afternoon. They'll pretty well determine what happened.
So there was no student flight involved?
No, there was no student flight involved in it at all.
Arthur Bedell, 58, retired 3 years ago from the New York Telephone Company in Burnt Hills, New York. Purchased land in Abra Valley at that time and moved here with his wife, Marilyn, in February. They were living in a mobile home on the site, waiting to build a house. Marilyn told Eyewitness News today that her husband was an engineer, a stickler for detail. He was shooting videotape of his land when the plane went down. The tape was to be sent to his children in Georgia. The Bedells ate breakfast at the Skyrider coffee shop at the Abra Valley Airport almost every morning. This morning was no exception. Carl Nichols called William Bedell a very friendly man with a good sense of humor.
I come out after I got done cooking. He says, I did a pretty good job this time. Keep practicing.
Marilyn Bedell was reading a book in the restaurant when she got the news. Investigators from the National Transportation Safety Board arrived late this afternoon to investigate the crash. Their report should be completed within the next few days. Matt Stevens, TV4 Eyewitness News, Abra Valley. The device arrived from Phoenix shortly after 7 tonight. At 300 pounds, it is so cumbersome that only the technician and the pilot could fly with it.
Pick it up.
The Pierce device is manufactured in California and has been used successfully many times in other states, mainly in Pennsylvania at Penn State University, where it was developed. Dr. Cecil Vaughn arrived a short time later, calling this a deja vu experience. In March, Dr. Vaughn and Dr. Jack Copeland of UMC used the unapproved Phoenix heart to sustain the life of 33-year-old Thomas Creighton of Tucson. Creighton had rejected a transplanted heart, and the device was used to keep him alive until another human donor could be found. Creighton died a short time after his second human heart transplant.
Dr. Vaughn, you got a minute to talk to us?
Dr. Copeland is on vacation in France, so Dr. Vaughn is working with UMC's second in command, Dr. Robert Emery.
They have a patient that's rejected a transplant, and they're having trouble supporting his blood pressure. What we plan to do is put in a ventricular assist device to tide the patient over. They had a heart donor available in Los Angeles, but the family decided, the donor's family decided at the last moment not to do it. So we lost several hours of time.
The search for a new human donor continues tonight. Matt Stevens, TV4, Eyewitness News.
Marshall Saddle on the Aspen Trail. We're just a few minutes down the trail, heading for the lunch ledge.
10-4.
The search is centered on some of the most rugged regions of the Catalinas, from the upper end of Lemon Creek to Sabino Canyon.
There are many waterfalls. They're hard to down climb, and it would be very easy to fall.
Steve! Steve, what?
Rescue workers, only a few of them here today, walk and yell the name. If Steve Wood is injured and can't move, he might holler back.
Steve! Steve Wood!
Wood was dropped off at Marshall Gulch by his uncle 8 days ago. 3 days later, he was supposed to call him for a ride from the Sabino Canyon Visitor Center. But on Sunday, Robert Wood reported his nephew 3 days overdue.
Set.
Other hikers reported seeing someone matching Wood's description a few days ago, but not lately, not today. Wood is 27, a machine shop worker from a Chicago suburb, here for a 2-week hiking trip alone.
This?
Dried fruit.
Dried fruit.
Robert Wood pours through the supplies his nephew was to have used this week on another hiking trip in the Rincons.
Yes, we feel that some sort of an accident happened and that maybe he can't get out of where he's at, that he's immobile. We don't know.
The missing hiker is due back in Illinois next Monday. Tomorrow, his parents will fly here to be closer to the search. Matt Stevens, TV4, Eyewitness News. The fire will consume 8,500 acres before it's out. Most of what burns will grow back when the monsoons come. The concern is for the crews who come and go with little rest and little protection against the heat. The Papago crew worked all night to keep the blaze from endangering the town of Buenos Aires. They succeeded.
All I'll just drop them off right there.
You know why you're so late getting back here?
Why?
We forgot it.
Oh, come on.
There have been a few cases of heat exhaustion and 2 scorpion bites.
He's got some swelling in the face, a little blotchiness, no problem breathing at this time. They should be there just shortly, and helicopter 320 will pick him up and bring him back in on this trip.
Okay, good enough, Walden. We have the emergency vehicle waiting for him. Thank you.
The man with the scorpion bite is one of 20 crew members from the state prison at Perryville. It has been a struggle to airlift enough water to the crews at different locations in the mountains. But all of the firefighters will return to camp by nightfall to catch up on many lost hours of sleep. Officials say they hope to have the blaze contained by tonight and under control by tomorrow morning. Good news for the ranchers who own the land that is threatened and for those who have been battling the heat for more than 2 days now. Matt Stevens, TV4 Eyewitness News, near the Baba Kiveri Mountains. It is a seasonal profession, a profitable but dangerous business. And getting out is almost always better than going in. The spirit wants to go back to the fire, but the body is weak after 21 hours in the heat,
Only water and food and sleep can bring the two together again.
How you guys doing?
Pretty good. How you doing?
First one I've ever been to. A little scary. Especially when I got right next to you. It was quite an experience. But I'd go out and do it again.
Just 21 years old, not enough close calls, some say, to be afraid yet.
Yeah.
There are four of us on the bottom. We were drinking canteen, and we looked to the side, and the fire, and I guess the wind took the fire up the side of the mountain, and we just had enough chance to just yell to the men on top to run, and they just took off running, and the fire went up to the top.
At night, the stories of this day and the plans for the next. Some are already talking about going to fight the fires in San Diego when this is over.
Did they give me any
Operations Chief Ted Moore learned of another fire in the Catalina district, his home base.
And now we have 9 people on the fire and 7 more responding.
5-pound water bags filled for the crew of Papagos that responded to the 7-mile post on Mount Lemmon near the old prison campsite. The lights that came down the hill contained the fire. The Papago crew finished the job by dawn. A morning reconnaissance flight for Ted Moore. The trouble spots in the Babakeveries are controlled and no longer visible from the air. The stubborn fire never made it from the mountains to the rangeland to the ranches to the Papago town of Buenos Aires. Time to demobilize most of the crews. The once precious water is now used to soften the ground to create a flat surface for the chopper to land. 3 at a time, they leave for the last time, headed for Montana, Oregon, or California. It's a seasonal profession, and the season doesn't last very long. Matt Stevens, TV4 Eyewitness News, near the Babakeveri Mountains. The view from the ridge tells only part of the story, the part about the horses and the people who ride them.
Look at me, Dad.
Summer is the slow season, too hot for anything but a cold shower and a good scrubbing. Some say people who can afford to buy horses can afford to own them. But increasingly, that statement is becoming a lie. The Pantano stables nearly went out of business this year because liability insurance is hard to find and harder to finance.
Insurance companies charged too little for what the risk was for too many years. And now it's catching up to them. And now they've got to swing the other way.
Moffitt knows of only one company in the country, Pine Top Insurance, that will handle outfitters and guides liability in Arizona.
Good, Christy, excellent. Just walk through your poles.
By next year, insurance agents say no companies will cover riding lessons. Larry Lord, who owns the Tucson Mountain Stables, says the Wild West is apparently too wild for big city insurance companies, even though most horsemen say lessons are the safest part of the business.
That's what we say. And I don't know who's writing the policy. I imagine the guy writing the policy has never been on a horse.
Lord's liability premium was $750 in 1984. It was $3,000 this year.
Dorothy says, I've had it. I'm not going. That's it. Come here, let me take her. I'll start her.
In 2.5 years of doing business, the Tucson Mountain Stables have never had a claim.
Hang on,
but if they ever do, the jump in premium would kill the operation.
You're probably looking at least 2, 3, or 4 times more than what you paid before, if they'll retain the risk. See, a lot of times they won't. They'll just say, we don't want to renew it. We've had bad experience with it. No.
Children are curious about a lot of things, not about business. They don't know that Larry Lord pays $25,000 a year for hay. They don't know that a hold harmless agreement signed by their parents won't hold water in court. They only know that riding horses is fun, that a pair of boots and a hat can make them feel like John Wayne or Annie Oakley. Riding horses makes little boys with glasses certain that all cowboys don't have 20/20 vision. Sometimes it's better to be a little blind, but the insurance companies say they've seen too much, lost too much money, and now it's time to saddle up and ride. Matt Stevens, TV4, Eyewitness News. In Safford, the concern is for the economy. How many jobs will be lost? Farmers and ranchers question the difference in grazing laws. The BLM is more lenient, they say. Good for some, bad for others. There is more apprehension than conflict here, much of it on the part of the Forest Service, which will be absorbed locally by the BLM.
We just don't have the image that the Forest Service has in that respect.
So are you getting a bad rap?
Well, I think if people look at actually what's going on the ground, I think that they would have to say that we're doing as good a job.
The Forest Service will actually gain about 240,000 acres in the state of Arizona, in the Prescott, Flagstaff, Phoenix, Tucson, Sierra Vista, and Douglas areas. What it will lose to the BLM is the land in and around Safford, which includes Mount Graham. It was discovered a generation before the Pilgrims arrived at Plymouth. Its resources feed the valley. Its presence feeds the spirit. Six of its caretakers will be part of the $1 million a year savings for the state. Nine others will join the BLM. Today, they toured the area with U.S. Forest Service Chief Max Peterson, here for the first time.
I expect you'd find a lot of people in the Forest Service who feel a very strong attachment to land such as this. And so I expect there's some level of concern of some people. But I think a lot of our people also know that BLM has some very fine people who also are concerned with land management.
The two agencies have performed basically identical services for many years. The differences are subtle and of little impact where protected land is concerned. Riggs Lake, 8,600 feet, stocked with trout too small to give a good fight, too rare to throw back. The land swap legislation will help the fishermen as taxpayers and as tourists, but it won't change their luck.
No, I got a stake with me.
Matt Stevens, TV4 Eyewitness News, Graham County, Arizona.
Well, my friends, they all think, you know, country music, girl.
To those who know it, this is not just country music, it's special. It makes your feet move without any help from the brain. It makes you wonder if you were born dizzy, and dizzy is a good way to be.
Now we'll play our slow waltz.
Okay, what color is it now?
G. G. Sydney's waltz, he called.
Tony Urbanowicz, Manitoba, Canada, a long way from the hills of Kentucky where fiddlers are born, not made, practicing an old Scotch tune, awaiting his first time on a stage ever.
It all comes out the same sort of, same type of music.
Sharon Miller from Iowa, 13 years old and a guaranteed winner in the 30 and under class. The only entrant in her first contest. It wouldn't have mattered.
The first place is Tony Urbanowicz.
Thank you, Larry.
Those who love this special music love it until their beards outgrow their bellies, until they can figure out why the man playing the big bass plays the big bass. They pay for it with sunburns, with exhaustion, and sometimes they have to pay the fiddler even when they haven't danced.
Time to get back to you. Thank you, sir. Bye-bye.
Yes.
Some people have to hold down the fort at lunchtime, but they still get hungry.
Well, it looks like take the stairs.
So they depend on Steve White, who always delivers, eventually.
Hi, how you doing? Comes to 3:35.
That's 2:35. Sometimes they don't even give me a tip. They just give me the regular money or write a check.
Oh!
We're gonna get hit. I got a large tea, two large Diet Cokes, a medium Coke, a grilled cheese sandwich, chicken wheat, chicken Italian, and some salad.
Philly's Finest is the only place downtown that delivers tuna platters and such to busy receptionists. More than 100 deliveries a day from 11:30 in the morning till 2 in the afternoon. Yep. Steve White makes most of them. It's tough working the streets, but somebody has to do it. Matt Stevens, TV4, Eyewitness News.
Matt Stevens is at University Medical Center with this latest report. Matt.
Martha, as you said, the prognosis is once again about as good as it can be. Michael Drummond is described as clinically stable but physically exhausted after yesterday's Jarvik 7 implant.
The surgery lasted 4.5 hours. When it was over, Michael Drummond's blood pressure and other vital signs were described as better than expected. The first Jarvik 7 implant at UMC left doctors with much more than the usual cautious optimism.
Nobody knows, but this man may have a chance of practically a normal lifespan.
He had a very large chest, so it was easy for us to put the heart in.
Dr. Jack Copeland, who performed the implant, said today the team felt no pressure now to find a human heart donor, that Drummond's condition would be allowed to stabilize, perhaps for as long as 2 weeks.
Is that a luxury you can afford? I mean, should a heart become available, let's say a donor heart becomes available in a week, doesn't that put you in a very tenuous position?
Well, I think a week would probably be okay. Anywhere from about a week to 3 weeks, I think, is our window for going ahead. So I think we have a 2 week period from 7 days to 21 where I would feel very comfortable going ahead with another transplant, and I think the chance of complications within that time period from the artificial heart is fairly small.
I just came down from visiting the staff and seeing the patient.
This morning, spokesperson Nina Trasoff said the patient and the Jarvik 7 were getting along very well.
And Rich told me that compared to what he and the team were taught to expect in human beings during their training period, this is well beyond anything that they could possibly have expected or hoped for.
Martha, at a very brief conference with reporters about 90 minutes ago, Trasoff said that Drummond's blood pressure was normal, his temperature about 100, which is good, and his heart output very excellent. Now, in just a few moments, Dr. Copeland, who performed the surgery, is going to brief the media as a whole for the first time today. And if that happens before the program ends, we'll come back to it.
Okay, we'll be looking forward to that, Matt. Thank you very much for your report.
The other thing I asked him is, do you want to write some notes to us? And at first he nodded his head, and then he sort of gave me the impression that he just didn't have enough energy, wasn't that interested right now. So those are the two things that I've noticed.
All right, Martha, to recap just a little bit, Michael Drummond, 25 years old, the youngest Jarvik 7 heart implant patient ever, suffering from a bit of a fever at this point, but blood pressure very normal and his heart rate excellent. Dr. Jack Copeland, his first media briefing of the day. We'll be back with more later at 4:30, 5 and 6, of course. And an interesting note, the family has apparently agreed to talk possibly tomorrow to the media. Back to you, Martha.
Very good. Thank you very much, Matt.
Good evening. It's 10 o'clock. I'm Matt Stevens. Uganda is sealed off tonight. The military leaders who seized power in a coup yesterday said today that the country's constitution has been suspended. The borders were closed just a few hours after General Belisio Okello took power. Today, Okello addressed the nation by radio, telling his people to remain calm. He also said the country would soon have free elections. But while citizens stayed in their homes, there were reports of looting, mostly by military personnel. Overthrown President Obote is now exiled to Kenya. In South Africa today, black rioters attacked soldiers and police in four segregated townships, wounding eight and killing one black constable. Today was also the 67th birthday of Nelson Mandela, the imprisoned black leader who advocates violence to overthrow the white regime. 2 days ago, the South African government banned celebrations planned for this day, and this morning the stadium where Mandela's followers were to have celebrated was empty, but for one unidentified man, alone with his thoughts. South Africa's state of emergency is now 8 days old. More than 1,100 blacks have been arrested since it began. But South Africans hope that this week's meeting between Bishop Desmond Tutu and President P.W. Botha, their first in 5 years, will help to ease tensions and bring an end to the state of emergency. In Israel today, mourners carried the coffins of two school teachers killed by Palestinian terrorists. Their bodies were found in a cave near Afula. In the streets, dozens of angry mourners screamed death to terrorists, calling for the execution of the killers. While the teachers were being buried, security forces blew up the homes of three Palestinian teenagers who had confessed to the killings. In Washington today, nine workmen injured, one seriously, at the D.C. Hilton Hotel. An explosion rocked the building where the men were repairing the damage caused by yesterday's electrical fire. As Marjorie Margolis reports tonight, the hotel's 3,700 guests were evacuated for the second straight night.
What they were hoping would not happen did. Well,
the FBI says Gary, Indiana is the murder capital of the United States, 54.8 murders per 100,000 population in 1984. Detroit was second, Miami third, New Orleans fourth, and Richmond, Virginia fifth. Phoenix and Tucson did not make the list of the top 25 cities released today. Fayette, Iowa didn't make the list either, and it never will, too small. And all the people there are probably too nice to kill each other. But they do fear that a lack of interest, or at least a lack of publicity, could kill the football program at their small college. So officials at Upper Iowa State have decided to advertise for football players. And as Cassandra Clayton reports tonight, the campaign seems to be working.
For Marty Hanahan, it was a chance to shuck his job as a courier and pursue his dream to play college football.
Coming up next, an overtime battle at Utterback and a pair of hikers home safe after a scary night in the Catalinas. Those stories and more in a moment. Please stay with us.